Ryan Gosling is freaking great. And in sort of a different way than any other actor. So let's talk about it. So obviously Ryan Gosling is a competent actor. He's been nominated for 2 Oscars and 4 Golden Globes. I don't really know anyone that thinks he's bad. And look at this kid. It's freaking adorable. Come on. He does have pretty great range. He can be wildly funny.
These are my 407s.
Oh, they're 407s. Can I see them?
Yeah. These offer a lot of support.
Right.
Whoa, come on!
What are you, in a fraternity?
Are you insane?
Are you in a fraternity?
You could have hit somebody. What was that?
I'm asking you a question. You in a fraternity?
No.
And also, deeply serious.
I know it's real.
But that's not really the point I'm trying to make. I'm instead going to argue that Ryan Gosling, the actor, is actually an auteur. Now, if you're a big cinema buff, you maybe have heard this term before, or maybe you've never heard it before in your life. And in either case, I'm gonna give you a little bit of background. So film critic and author Andrew Saris wrote a journal called Notes on the Auteur Theory in 1962, in which he gave what was, in his opinion, the best definition of what made a director an auteur. Now, it's not a perfect definition or anything, but I think it is a good starting ground to figure out what makes a director, at least, an auteur. And he had 3 qualifications. The first is a director's technical competence. Sarah says that a great director has to at least be a good director. Secondly, he argues it is the distinguishable personality of a director over a group of films. A director must exhibit certain recurrent characteristics of style, which is his signature. And lastly, he defined the most central element in a director's style as interior meaning, which is, in his words, extrapolated from the tension between the director's personality and his material. So in other words, the first qualification is their technical competence, the second, their distinguishable style, and third, their intended meaning across a group of films. So before you stop me, I know you're probably thinking, whoa, whoa, whoa. Sounds like this was made to define a director as an auteur, not an actor. And you're right. But here's the thing. I kind of think you might be able to make the case. And the only reason I think more people haven't talked about it is because there's just not that many actors who can fit all 3 criteria. So let's break them down. So first is technical competence. This is a little bit obvious. I think for the purposes of this video, any actor I'm going to talk about is at least considered good by some standard. And if, honestly, if you're of the mind that Ryan Gosling is not good already,
then get the hell out, because he can't be my friend.
The point is, I'm not trying to make the point that he's a good or bad actor. I think I'm just going to assume that he is. So that one's taken care of. So the second criteria is a signature style. And it's really easy to spot with a lot of directors. I mean, Wes Anderson has the stilted dialogue and the two-dimensional plane. Kubrick has the central focus point line. Spielberg has the subtle oneer and so on. It's not too hard to pick out those stylistic characterizations in a director. It is a little bit harder to see with actors. I would argue that many actors do return to a similar actor's toolbox in many of their roles. Philip Seymour Hoffman, for example, is a very talented character actor. He's played a lot of different kinds of characters, but he seems to return to this indignant frustration in many of his characters.
You have no right to act on your own. You have taken vows, obedience being one. You answer to us.
You seem to know the answers to your questions. Why do you ask?
I'm sorry, you're unwilling to defend your beliefs in any kind of rational
way. Oh, if you already know the answers to your questions, then why ask? Pig f***! Shut up! Will you shut up? Shut up! Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
With actors who are typecast, it's actually a lot easier to see. I mean, Morgan Freeman always seems to play the wise old mentor, and Jesse Eisenberg always plays like a socially awkward yet sometimes endearing loser, and so on. So what about our boy Ryan? Well, it's a little harder because he toes the line between a leading man and a character actor pretty well between a lot of his roles. He's done a lot of variety. He has played a lot of suave and confident leads, but he's also played a lot more awkward or atypical leading men. But if I have to pick the one recurring signature in Gosling's acting tool belt, it would be what I would call a quiet charisma. He's able to present so much charismatic attitude with so little. He's an extremely likable guy, no matter what the role, and yet he can usually pull it off without resorting to the typical cool guy formula. So the first two criteria can be met by a lot of directors and many actors. But I think the third thing is the reason that we typically don't consider actors as being auteurs and usually just directors. And that would be intended meaning. So this one's tricky. Intended meaning across a body of works. I think it's easy to see with directors, once again, but not with actors. Because for most actors, I think they're handed a script by the director or writer or whoever, and they work with what they're given. The story is there already, so they're there to just enhance it. I mean, it's for this reason why I think a lot of people might not consider someone like David Fincher an auteur as a director, because he doesn't write his own scripts. And that's a whole other discussion for another video, but the point I'm trying to make is, can an actor be considered an auteur when they don't write the movie? So let's talk about theme. In a movie, the theme typically comes from the writing, the script. The theme doesn't usually come from the camera or the direction or the acting performance, typically. But those things enhance the theme of a movie where the script brings it in the first place. So there you go. An actor can't be an auteur, right? Well, here's the thing. I've watched a lot of Ryan Gosling movies, and I have this theory that there is a recurring theme in almost every single one of them. And it doesn't have anything to do necessarily with how he acts, but with what movies he chooses to act in. And that theme is love and commitment. So I honestly can't think of like any movies that Ryan Gosling's been in where love and commitment is not at least one of the central themes. I mean, across all genres and styles of movies he's been in, I think I see this in every single one in some way or another. So let's look at a few examples. So Ryan's career began as a child, but I think most people really saw who he was after The Notebook, a romance drama. So just a few years later, the world saw a very different side of him in Lars and the Real Girl. In the film, he plays an awkward social misfit who falls in love with a sex doll. Yeah, it's pretty weird. Lars loves the doll with his whole heart, and the townspeople around him slowly adapt to his situation, and they play along as if she's a real person in order to help him. The commitment to the situation is ultimately brought to a close when the doll, Bianca, dies, and they hold a funeral service. In the end, Lars asks Margot, a woman who has shown a real interest in him earlier in the film, to go on a walk, signifying that perhaps he has learned to feel for a real person. So Drive is my favorite movie of all time. I'm a little biased, but for as disturbing the violence and how opaque the storytelling can be, the central conflict of the film revolves around the driver's love and commitment to Irene, a woman in his apartment building. This isn't a typical love story, though. The driver meets Irene, and almost immediately after falling in love with her and her kid, Irene's husband returns from prison, and the driver has to step aside. But when Irene's husband, Standard, is found beat up by a previous employer, the driver steps in. They want him to rob a pawn shop, and Driver agrees to help, knowing that if Standard fails, it could be very bad news for Irene and her son. But the thing is, he never ends up with her, because like most crime films, everything goes horribly wrong in the end. But nonetheless, love and commitment. So I already have a whole video on this channel unpacking this movie, so I'll just make this brief. I think one of the central themes of the film is that to stay in a committed relationship, especially marriage, is almost always more meaningful and more emotionally powerful than any other kind of physical or romantic or emotional relationship. The Ides of March revolves around Gosling's Stephen Myers, a campaign manager for presidential candidate Mike Morris, played by George Clooney. The conflict of the film revolves around Myers' commitment to Morris's campaign. Myers is devoted to Morris. He truly believes in not only his politics, but that he is the only candidate that can win the race. But ties are tested when Stephen meets with the enemy campaign manager. In politics, at least according to Hoffman's character, loyalty is the only thing that really matters.
There's only one thing I value in this world, and that's loyalty. Without it, you're nothing.
Later in the film, when Myers learns that Morris got an intern pregnant, he uses that information to get himself back on Morris's team and Hoffman fired.
Well, I don't believe in extortion. I don't believe in tying myself to you for the next 8 years.
4 years. Let's not get ahead of ourselves.
It is his love of the campaign and his commitment to the political game that ultimately shatters his idealism for the future of politics. He is undone by everything he witnessed, but despite the opportunities to leave at any time, he stays vigilant and remains a cog in the political machine.
Can you give us some insight into how this whole thing unfolded?
Straight geese order, came back with 80 chains. Now the silly bitches calling me like every day.
Blade Runner 2049 is extremely dense. It's thematically rich with nuance and detail, but one plot thread that I think is the most effective and powerful is the relationship between Gosling's Agent K and his AI hologram girlfriend, Joy. In an article for The Verge, this person wrote, "There's a kind of underlying hope in Blade Runner 2049 that Joy is growing to be more than her programming, that she loves K of her own agency and isn't just an empty fantasy. Her caring behavior for him when he's hurt or when her existence might threaten his suggests that she's devoted to him. When her data is destroyed, K realizes how she defined him. K's personal ascension comes as a surprise to him, but it leads him to commit to the higher purpose of saving Deckard and reuniting him with his daughter. K molds Joy into what he wants her to be, but she molds him in return. They both seem to be moving beyond their programming because of their love for each other. Their relationship between an android boy and a holographic girl, each looking for something more and to be something more, makes for one of the most thought-provoking pairings in recent science fiction."
I'm so happy when I'm with you.
You don't have to say that.
So there you have it. I hope I made my point. Obviously, there's a lot of films I had to skip over for this. I didn't want this video to be too long, but I would encourage you to check them out on your own if you haven't seen them. Some more examples of films that I think have some of the same themes and Ryan Gosling's traditional quiet charisma, as I called it, would be The Place Beyond the Pines, First Man, La La Land, Blue Valentine, and even Gangster Squad. So thanks for watching. Thanks for tuning in. I hope to make more content like this in the future. I hope you liked it. Let me know in the comments if you did or if you didn't. And let me know what you think. Do you agree? Do you disagree? Is Ryan Gosling really that great? Is he any different than any other actor? Why do all of his movies have the same themes? Or am I wrong? Should I leave the internet forever? Let me know. And until next time, peace out.